conversations of Bhagwan with students and teachers during the period 2001. And I am mentioning the months and the period with a reference to the coverage published in Telugu Sanatana Sarathi. I usually write what all that is transacted here, the divine dialogues with Swami, and send them for publication to Telugu Sanatana Sarathi. So the chronology, the months I am mentioning, refer to the month of publication in Telugu Sanatana Sarathi. I think I am clear. So we started with the year 2001. Having done the whole of 2002 with the divine grace, we have come to 2001, all that relating to months, June 2001. With prayers to Swami, soliciting His blessings on everybody here, I start this evening the month July, year 2001. We'll go episode after episode. The first episode, July, year 2001. We'll go episode after episode. The first episode, month of July 2001. This is a mythological matter. I do not know how many of you know Ramayana story, how many of you know the story of Mahabharata. But having been here several times before, having heard Bhagwan's discourses, it is my foolishness to think that you have no idea. I am not that bad as that. So you'll be certainly having some idea. Having heard Bhagwan's discourses, it is my foolishness to think that you have no idea. I am not that bad as that. So you'll be certainly having some idea of the great epic Ramayana. One day, Bhagwan, as usual, sat on the chair in the evening after completing his interviews. Then he started in a disappointing way. What he said was, ideas are perverted today. Behavior is not proper today. Affections are missing. Times have changed. Mentalities and attitudes of people are very disappointing. They are totally different from the past. That was the initial comment of Bhagwan. Then Bhagwan started substantiating his statement by making references to the mythology of this land. Bhagwan said, in the ancient days, values had played a predominant role in society. People estimated values in very high esteem. And today, values are on the decline. He made a mention of three wives of the king Dasharatha from that epic Ramayana. Baba started telling like this. The three wives of the king, they were so intimate that they had a relationship as if they are born to the same mother. Sisterly feeling they had. They never had any sort of competition. They lived in unity and love. And then Bhagavan mentioned a point connected with the birth of Rama, Lakshmana, Bharata, Shatrughna, the four brothers of that great epic Ramayana. Am I all right? You follow me? Then, King Dasharatha had to marry three wives. Why? He didn't get children, he didn't have any children after getting married for the first time. So the first wife prayed to him again and again to get married. Because the kingdom, there should be heir to the throne. So, in response to her prayers, he married again. Even then he didn't have children. Both the queens prayed to him to marry. And he married another. Like that he had three wives. The name of the first wife is Kausalya. Second wife, Sumitra. The youngest, Kaikeyi. Well, he was deeply frustrated. As he didn't have children still. So, his preceptor, Vasistha, advised that she should perform yaga, a sacred ritual, to appease gods, so that he will be blessed with children. So, Dasharatha, with these three queens, did yaga as per the instructions of the family preceptor, Vasistha. That's how the story goes. And out of the fire came out the fire god with a golden vessel of pudding. You know, pudding, something like your porridge. And there the fire god said, "O king, let your three queens divide among themselves into three parts this pudding and partake tonight, and they will beget children." That was the blessing of the fire god, and the fire god disappeared. Accordingly, King Dasharatha came out, asked for three golden vessels and divided that rice pudding into three parts, called the wives and gave one each with instructions to eat with a word of prayer without fail in order to have children. Yes, three queens had their head bath, first queen, second queen and also third queen. But it so happened, the second queen, Sumitra, after having had her head bath, she climbed up to the terrace of that palace and kept that golden vessel of rice pudding on the parapet wall and started drying her hair. A thought flashed into her mind, which goes like this. Look here. If the elder one, Kausalya, the first queen, is to have a son, he is going to be the king. Or by any chance, if the youngest queen, Kaika, is to have a son, he will be the king as per the promise given by Dasharatha at the time of marriage. Anyway, in either case, I am going to be the loser. If I have children, they have to serve either the son of the first wife or the son of the third wife. My son can never come to the position. See, a thought flashed into her mind. In the meantime, an eagle came, picked up this golden tumbler with rice pudding and ran away, flew from that place. Then Sumitra was panicky. with her legs trembling, with the voice fumbling, totally afraid of her husband for not partaking this rice pudding as per the instructions given, afraid of the punishment, she went softly, prayerfully to the first queen, Kausalya. She told what all had happened to her. Similarly, she also told the youngest queen, Kaika, what all that happened to her. See, you have that golden cup with rice pudding. You also have golden cup with rice pudding. Why my golden cup is lost? Because that eagle came and flew with this golden cup. I don't know what would happen to me. I don't know what punishment would be given to me by King Dasharatha. I am very much afraid, sister. You should help me. Naturally, the two others took pity upon her. The first queen said, "Don't worry. I'll give half of my share. Don't worry. Bring another golden cup. I'll give half of my lot." Similarly, the other one, the youngest one, Kaika, came and said, "Don't worry, sister. I'll give half of my lot." Like that, the middle one, Sumitra, got half quota from the first queen, Kausalya, and half from the last queen, Kaika. Somehow, all of them did prayer, worship, and they partook the rice pudding that night as per the instructions. And all of them, naturally by the grace of fire god, as a result of that sacred ritual, they begot sons. The first queen, Kausalya, she gave birth to Ramachandra. The youngest, Kaika, gave birth to Bharata. Whereas the second and Sumitra, she gave birth to twins. One is Lakshmana, the other one is Shatrughna. The reason is, she had half the share from Kausalya, other half the share from Kaika, so she gave birth to twins. And Baba started explaining this. Look here. This is the divine plan. Out of the two that Sumitra had, Lakshmana always stayed in the company of Rama. The other one, Shatrughna, always stayed in the company of Bharata. The first half of the cup for the share she had from Kausalya resulted in the birth of Lakshmana. So Lakshmana was always in the company of Rama. The half cup share she had from Kaika was responsible for the birth of Shatrughna, who always spent the time in the company of Bharata. Sumitra was so lucky that both her sons served their brothers. This Bhagavan started explaining, will you find that kind of love, that kind of intimacy, that sort of sympathy and consideration among queens of this type? All the three are the wives of the king. They never fought with each other. They lived in perfect harmony and unity. And then Bhagavan mentioned a small anecdote from Ramayana. Four swings or cradles were ordered, and each child is kept in the cradle and made to sleep. But Lakshmana went on crying day in, day out. The mother Sumitra could not do anything to stop the baby from crying. Nobody in the kingdom could solve the problem. The child went on crying. But finally the preceptor Vasishtha came and said, "Look here, Lakshmana cannot stay away from Rama, took this child and placed in the same cradle where Rama was lying. So they lifted Lakshmana baby and made him rest by the side of Rama, and the baby stopped crying. Like this, right from the beginning, Lakshmana followed Rama as his shadow. Similarly, Shatrughna followed Bharata as his shadow. They always lived together. That was the kind of fraternity, brotherhood they had. Well, you must have understood by now that my nature is to always put questions, to get answers from Bhagwan Baba, because answers from Bhagwan Baba are authentic. We don't have to question them, because he is same old Rama, born now as Bhagwan Sri Sat Sai Baba. He will be able to explain much better in a more authentic way than anybody, than in any book for that matter. Then I said, Swami, there are two other brothers in Ramayana. One is Vali, the other is Sugriva. There was no brotherhood between them. Though they were brothers, they always fought with each other. Whereas today you are telling that Rama, Lakshmana, Bharata, Shatrughna, they lived in friendship, understanding and fraternity. You also said Kausalya, Sumitra, Kaikeyi, they had the relationship and the bondage of love only. But I don't find any kind of understanding or enmity between Vali and Sugriva. Though they are brothers, they fought with each other. How do you explain, Swami? With a smile he said, there was no fighting between them. There was no enmity between them. There was only misunderstanding. Oh, I see. Why, Swami, misunderstanding? The elder brother Vali had an enemy by name Dundubhi. This Dundubhi was always fighting with Vali over an issue involving a woman. And the Dundubhi came to Vali and said, come on, fight with me if you have guts. Vali, being a warrior, he started chasing Dundubhi. Dundubhi was running in the front and Vali was chasing him. At that moment, Vali called his younger brother Sugriva. Brother, I am leaving this kingdom. I am going to fight with my enemy. You be in charge of this kingdom until I return. But Sugriva felt his elder brother Vali may need his help. So instead of staying in the kingdom, he too started running along with Vali, chasing Dundubhi. So in the front was running Dundubhi, after him Vali, and behind him Sugriva. Finally they reached a cave, and Dundubhi ran into the cave in order to hide himself from being killed by Vali. Then Vali turned back and saw Sugriva, younger brother, following him. He told him, please don't follow me. You be here at the entrance. You be here at the entrance. If you follow me, if both of us are killed, who will rule the kingdom there? With all good intentions, he asked his younger brother to stay at the entrance of the cave, and Vali chased Dundubhi. They ran for days and weeks. Ultimately, Vali caught hold of Dundubhi and killed him. Being a mighty personality, hefty personality, the blood started flowing out of the cave. And Sugriva, at the entrance, noticed blood flowing out of the cave. Then he thought, his brother also died in the battle, fighting with Dundubhi. So he should go back to his kingdom to rule that. In the absence of elder brother, younger brother should serve as the king. So he brought a very big boulder, something like a door, kept at the entrance, and went back and started looking after the kingdom. In the meantime, Vali started returning. He saw the big boulder at the entrance. He gave a kick. It fell down. Then he ran to his kingdom. There he saw his younger brother, Sugriva, on the throne by the side of queens on either side, enjoying his time. Then Vali thought that Sugriva was actually waiting for his death. He has totally misunderstood him. Out of fury and anger, he gave him a kick on his chest. Sugriva fell down, cried. He started pleading with him, "Brother, I have no intention to rule the kingdom. Please understand me. Since the blood started coming out of the cave, I thought that you died there. Therefore, I came here to take charge of kingdom. Please don't misunderstand me." But his brother said, "Shut up. I know your intention." That's how the enmity started. That's where hatred began. In fact, Vali and Sugriva are brothers. They are very fond of each other, but for misunderstanding. I can only tell you, brothers and sisters here, Bhagavan Sri Satya Sai Baba will never make any role, any single character cheap. He will take every position, every role to exalted heights by telling some message behind every character. Then, Swami, I started speaking. "What a nice story it is, Swami. I have not heard before. Thank you very much. But..." What happened? "Swami, I heard of a boy by name Dhruva, who didn't get along well with his brother, had a fight with him. You say that epics speak of total brotherhood, all idealism. How do you explain the relationship between Dhruva and his brother?" Then Baba started narrating the whole story. "Dhruva happens to be the son of a king by name Uttanapada, a king. That king Uttanapada had two wives. One is Suruchi, the other one is Suniti. Suruchi had a son by name Uttama. Suniti had a son by name Dhruva. But the king Uttanapada was very fond of Suruchi and not of Suniti." Here, friends, I should tell you, Suruchi and Suniti are two names with an inner meaning. Suruchi meaning the one who is agreeable, the one who is so endearing. Suniti, the one who is moral. The names also convey some message without waiting for any explanation. Every name is self-explanatory. Now one day, when the king Uttanapada was seated on the throne, Uttama, the son of his second wife, Suruchi, came and sat on his lap. This was noticed by Dhruva, the son of the first wife, Suniti. And Dhruva also wanted to sit on the other lap of the father. The boy started running. But the stepmother, Suruchi, didn't like this. He has pushed that boy away from the father and said, "You have no business to sit on the lap of your father. Get out," she shouted. Dhruva was very much sad and then told his mother, "I was not permitted to sit on the lap of the father like the other brother. What can I do?" The mother also cried and said, "There is no alternative. I cannot help you, my son." That's what she said. Then Dhruva decided to do some penance, please God, and get the right to sit on the lap of the father. While he was going to the forest, he met on the way one sage by name Narada. Narada said, "Oh boy, where are you going?" He said, "Oh sage, my humble salutations to you. I am going to do penance in the thick forest. I want the God to be pleased with me and grant my wish to sit on the lap of my father." Narada took pity upon him and gave him some mantra to repeat. Accordingly, Dhruva went to the thick forest, started repeating God's name, mantra, again and again. God manifested in front of him and said, "Oh boy, what do you want?" This boy Dhruva said, "I want liberation." Then God said, No. You started your penance with the sole aim of getting the right to sit on the lap of the father. That was your original wish. Now you are asking for liberation. You are wrong. You should not do that. Moreover, there is a long time for you to be liberated. You are still a young boy. You get married, rule the kingdom, and after you leave this body, you will be liberated. And you will remain as a star in the sky, permanently. And today also, people refer to that Dhruva star, even today, which shines more than the other stars. That's what Bhagwan explained that day. Then I said, "Swami, I wonder how beautifully you raise the level of every character. It is only possible to you, not for anybody. You don't consider any character mean or low. You take them to heights. I really wonder." This I said joyfully. Baba replied like this, "Anil Kumar, all are good to me. All appear good to me. From my point of view, there are none who are bad. All are good. Because you wear colored glasses, some look bad to you. But to me, all are good. Because I am full of love. With love, you find everything good and perfect. However," this is the conditional clause of Bhagavan, "however, I appear to be serious, I appear to be disturbed, I appear to be angry, not that you are bad, no. I want to correct you with the feeling that you may turn bad later. I want you to be ideal. To correct you, I pretend to be angry, but anger is not in me." That's what Baba said. Then I said, "Swami, you were so kind enough to have spoken about Ramayana as an ideal epic depicting unity, coordination, love and understanding. But my doubt is, Bharata is not like that. Mahabharata, another epic, is not like that. It does not speak of brotherhood. It does not speak of ideals. But you say that all ancient epics are full of ideals. I don't understand, Swami. Please explain. Then Swami started explaining like this. You are mistaken. There are brothers Kauravas, 100. Kauravas, 100 brothers. Pandavas, 5 brothers. Total 105. You are telling that there is no brotherhood among them. There is no love among them. You are wrong. Why? The eldest of the 5 of the Pandavas, Dharmaja, went in search of some drinking water somewhere far away. And there he saw a tank out of which he wanted to collect some drinking water for his brothers. When he is about to touch that water, some angel appeared, Gandharva appeared and said, "Don't touch this water. Don't touch this water. You have no authority." He said, "My brothers are dying out of thirst. I want water, please." Then that angel Gandharva said, "If you answer my questions, I'll permit you to fetch water and grant boons also." Dharmaja answered all the questions most satisfactorily, which are very beautiful, wonderful questions. They are called Yaksha Prashna. Prashna is a question put by Yaksha, the angel. We'll have a separate session on Yaksha Prashna, full of deep philosophy, which will be of immense interest to all of you. Incidentally, if you don't mistake me, I am in all praise of all of you here because you don't seem to be fed up with me. You don't seem to be bored with me. You don't seem to take my speech monotonous. I sincerely say it reflects more of your devotion to Bhagavan than my capacity to speak. I know full well about that point. I really appreciate your interest in the subject. May God bless you. Now, this angel Gandharva was totally pleased with the eldest of Pandavas, Dharmaja, and then said, "What do you want? What do you want?" Dharmaja said, "I want all my brothers to be brought back to life." In fact, every brother went there to the tank. Every brother made an attempt to drink water, could not answer his questions. They were cursed to death. So all the fellows died there. Only Dharmaja survived. And when Yaksha asked, "What is your desire?" "Only one desire, that all my brothers should be brought back to life." With the result, all the 104 brothers are brought back to life. Then somebody asked Dharmaja, "Look here, those 100 Kauravas are your enemies. You Pandavas are 5. You should not have asked for the revival of those 100 sons, Kauravas, who are your dead enemies." Then Dharmaja, eldest, started explaining this way. among us, those 100 belong to one party, we 5 belong to another party. But when we face the third person, we are not 100:5, we are 105. We stand united. If it's a matter of fight with the third person, what a lesson it is. Even today, if all nations learn to stand united, if all people learn to stand united, the world would be a paradise. The world would be the very heaven beyond doubt. That's how Bhagavan explained. Then, Swami, in Mahabharata, there are two characters I have come across. One is Vidura, other is Sanjaya. Two characters. Of the two, who is greater than the other? That is my question. Both are great people, both are noble people. But I wanted to grade them, you know, first class, second class, in the examination model. But our compassionate God, in His infinite mercy, gave the answer. Vidura is a scholar. He is fully familiar with ethics, morals, and conduct of life. Whereas the other man, Sanjaya, always stayed in the company of Krishna, led a righteous life, he led a spiritual life, and therefore Sanjaya is greater than Vidura, he said. Oh, I see, Swami. Who is Sanjaya, Swami? Is the Sanjaya I know you are speaking about? Because we all think that Vidura is greater than Sanjaya. Swami said, it was the Sanjaya who heard Bhagavad Gita and started reporting to Dhritarashtra. It was Sanjaya who could see all the battlefield there as in TV and started explaining to Dhritarashtra. Therefore, Sanjaya is certainly greater than Vidura. Swami, having heard these nice stories from you, I have one question, Bhagavan. You have always questions. Come and ask, what is your question? Swami, what is pralaya? Pralaya means extinction. Extinction. What is pralaya? Then, is this extinction of humanity due to man's actions or God's will? How is it going to happen? How is pralaya, extinction of humanity, going to happen? Is it because of the mistake of man or the will of God? God won't accept his mistake. He will defend his own stand, as usual. Now he looked at me and said, it is only man's fault leading to extinction. God is not responsible. Oh, I see. Then what is the position of God? God is the witness. That's all. He is not responsible. Swami, how are we responsible then? Your selfishness, your greed, hatred, lust, anger, all your weaknesses lead to pralaya or extinction. God is not the cause, because He is the other name of love. That's what Bhagavan said. And He made a mention of an earthquake there in Gujarat. You must have heard about it. Swami made, there is a loss of human lives numbering to thousands. That is a sort of pralaya. That's how Bhagavan said. And today, the modern mind of selfishness, their behavior is so distorted, diverted, perverted. They are only responsible for pralaya or extinction. Swami, I think we are not responsible. They are the effects of Kali age. Prabhava. Prabhava means effect. So I am bad because of the effect of Kali age. So humanity cannot be blamed, Swami. The Kali age is such. What can I do? Bhagavan immediately said, hey, why do you say like that? It is not prabhava. You should not change your swabhava, your nature, according to prabhava. Those influences should not affect you. You should not change your nature, swabhava, being victim to prabhava, effects there. That's what Bhagavan said. This is a lesson, my friends, which I want to explain. Swabhava is the nature. Prabhava, the effect. Because I am affected by the modern culture, because I am affected by modern civilization, I should not change my nature. All that is external is prabhava, the effect. But all that is mine, innate, inborn, is swabhava, my own nature. Baba said, never change your nature according to the surrounding influences. I see somebody smoking. That is prabhava. So let me also smoke. Meaning I am changing my swabhava, which is wrong. So let there be any number of influences. We should not change. That is the lesson. In the meantime, he called from the devotees one person. Come here. What are you doing? He said, Swami, well, I run the canteen in the super speciality hospital. Good. Then Bhagavan, with all affection, softly he said, look here, you should maintain same standard, equal to, same as our hostel and our canteen. The items should not only be delicious, they should also be quantitatively good. So all the food that you serve should be qualitatively and quantitatively rich enough. And moreover, look here, prices should not be very high. Bring down the prices. So many devotees are coming here. They can't spend all the money like that. So it should be cheap. No profit, no loss motive. Because we are not running any business here. That's what Bhagavan has said. Then while talking to that man, he looked at me. Then he said, look here, all these things I have to take care of myself. I have to inquire what is happening there in the canteen, what is happening in the college, what is happening in the stores, what is happening in the hospital. All these things I notice, you know that. I have to take care of them. I have to personally take care of them. That's what Baba is. His Swami explained that. On hearing that, to be honest enough, I took pity upon him. Because there is nobody to help him. He has to struggle a lot. Then suddenly, he looked at a book I was holding. The title of the book is Steps to Happiness. He has to get that book. Yes. What is it? It's not any novel or any fiction. With all the courage I took it. Swami looked at that book and read the title, Steps to Happiness? Yes, Swami. Then he said, are there any steps to happiness? What am I to say? Swami, I am yet to read it. I can reply only after I finish. Then Baba said, there are no steps to happiness. Happiness is only one, that's all, there are no other steps. Oh, Swami, only one, what is it? Union with God is happiness. Union with God is happiness. There are no steps to happiness. So saying, Swami left that place that evening. And then I pass on to the next episode. Next episode in the month of July, 2001. This is an interesting session. I do not mean that the earlier ones are not interesting. One is more interesting than the other. The interest is deeper and deeper, more and more, as we complete one session after another session. The divine dialogues are nectarine. The divine conversations are so precious. They are so valuable. Well, our friends here, trying to make the divine conversations available to all the devotees all over the world, please believe me, from the bottom of my heart I am telling you, yours is the highest and the greatest service. There is no doubt about it. If I do some work somewhere, next day I may have to do it again. Single-handed, I cannot do it. Baba gave one definition to this word service. I want all of you to understand. Because you may not be aware of the service you are doing. Therefore, I had to tell you, not to flatter you, because I don't expect anything from anybody. You must have known by now. I don't expect anything from anybody, anytime. It is enough if I receive His boundless grace and mercy. That's enough. It is enough if He talks to me every day like this. It is enough if I convey the message like this to everybody. This is the thing I like most. Nothing else. Nothing else. What did Baba say to this word service, definition of service? Anything that you do to take a person near God is the highest act of service. Serving in the canteen, the stores, they are acts of service, no doubt. But the highest service is this, to share the message of Sai with everybody. To take devotees closer and closer to God. What more do we want in life? We thank Swami for the opportunity given to us. Within the time left, I can talk to you on karma, K-A-R-M-A, action. Bhagavan spoke to us that evening on this topic, karma. Karma is action. Most of you know that. He referred to various types of karmas, various types of actions, and permitted me liberally, generously, to put questions in between, so that the topic will go in a particular direction. When Swami is speaking on karma, I should not put a question on bhakti. Devotion. Wrong. I should not say, Swami, speak of your childhood days. They don't fit in the context. So we should carry on the discussion along the same wavelength. with which Bhagavan initiates. So he decided to speak on karma that evening. Oh, what a nice talk it is. This point, first point with which I am going to start, may be quite new to the foreigners. Why? Because this concept is not there in any other religion. Karma is of three types. Karma has another meaning also. The fruits of action, the consequences of action, the reward. They are also the meanings of this word karma. Swami mentioned three names. One, the reward. They are also the meanings of this word karma. Swami mentioned three names. One, prarabdha. Prarabdha karma, meaning the consequences or the results of the past life, actions of the previous life. Am I clear, please? Prarabdha. The second, the results of the actions in the present life is called sanchita. The third one, the results of the actions in the present life is called sanchita. The third one, the results of actions in future, they are called agami. Agami. So the consequences of the results we get from all the three periods of time, past, present and future. Those of the past are called prarabdha, those of the present are sanchita, and those of the next are agami. That's what Bhagavan has said. Swami, what is the difference between these three? Anyhow, consequences of our actions, whether they are the past or present or future, what does it matter? Would you please tell us the difference between them? Then Baba said, whether they are of the past or the present or future, be definite, be certain that you cannot escape from the consequences of your actions. Good actions will bear good results. Bad actions will yield bad results. You cannot escape from the consequences of your actions. Brothers and sisters, as we act, let us be aware of this. We may act with all the smile and face the consequence with the tears, by which time it will be too late. Let us act well, so the results also will be equally well. It is a caution, if not a warning. Bhagavan gave one example. Here is a train. It has three compartments: first class, second class, third class compartments. The whole train runs and reaches platform. All the three compartments reach there. Not only first class compartment, not merely second class compartment, never only third class compartment. All the three compartments reach the platform. Similarly, the consequences of the three periods of time will make you face them, accept the results, face the challenges. Good for good, bad for bad, whatever may be. That's what Bhagavan has said. With the last point, I'll close for this session. Swami, today we see many bad people prospering. Don't they face consequences? Whereas a fellow like me faces so many difficulties. While a fellow has no problem at all. He is rogue number one. But he seems to prosper. Well, I don't have anything after all. Why should it happen? Baba said, it may appear like that. Anipinsu. It may seem like that. But results of actions, tinipinsu. It will make you face it unconditionally. It may appear, anipinsu, as if they escaped. But it will make you face it, tinipinsu, without any difficulty. That's what Bhagavan has said. And we proceed with the rest of the matter, I think tomorrow, right? Tomorrow. Oh.